Hello everyone! In this video, we'll examine the great orthogonality theorem. The equation is not tiny, but we will break it down into smaller pieces and it will be manageable. I will also introduce you to five important rules, which are about irreducible representations and their characteristics. These rules will allow us, for instance, to complete the empty fields in this character table. This is a summary of the great orthogonality theorem. Let's focus on symbols. H is called the order of the group, and it simply equals to the number of elements in the group. In C3V group, we have E, two rotations, and three reflections, so H equals 6. L is the dimension of an irrep, so L is 1 for A and B, 2 for E irreps, and so on. Because GOT addresses all the irreps in the group by making a list of them, first irrep, second, and so on, so we need to keep track of what dimension we are talking about. The dimension of ith irrep is denoted Li. Let's notice that this summary talks about h-dimensional vectors. So these vectors are made from as many components as there are operations in the group. Where are the vectors? Well, here they are. For C3V is the green, blue, purple, brown, orange, and light green. These vectors are made from elements of matrices that constitute any one of irreps in the group. Also, please notice that this table is not strictly a character table, because the E irrep is written in full, instead of only characters. I also made sure that the elements are not collected into classes, otherwise it would be a bit harder to notice that these vectors are indeed h-dimensional. Let's move on to the core of GOT. All of the colored vectors are mutually orthogonal. Recall that two vectors are orthogonal when the dot product of the two vectors is zero. GOT also says that the square of length of any of these vectors has some constant value. I hope you recall how to calculate the length of a vector. This vector is of length 5. It's just Pythagoras theory. Notice what we do. We take a dot product of the vector by itself, and then we take the root of it. So the square of length is just dotting the vector by itself. And this definition of vector length can be extended to higher dimensions. So coming back to GOT, when we dot any of these vectors by itself, it will be equal to h divided by the dimension of the irrep that the vector belongs to. Let's test it. GOT states that any two vectors from the table are orthogonal. Let's break it into two subcategories: different vectors from matrices of different representations, and different vectors from matrices of the same representation. Now let's take some example vectors and test it out. In the first case, I dotted A2 with a blue vector from E irrep, and in the second case, I took two vectors from E irrep. And obviously they are orthogonal. Now, let's look at some formulas that describe these two situations. R denotes various operations in the group, tau I R M N denotes the element of the mth row and the nth column of the matrix corresponding to an operation R in the ith irrep. Bit mouthful. Notice that in the first equation, we have tau I dotted with tau j, meaning the vectors come from different representations. You might notice that in both parts of this equation, we have mn, but this is just a compact mathematical notation. Let's say some group has two E irreps, and here are the matrices. The first equation says that we can take the dot product of the vectors made from, for instance, A21 entries of the first representation with a vector that is made from, for instance, A11 entries of the second representation. Because we know the equation refers to different irreps, then there is no point taking different symbols to denote rows and columns of the two vectors that we are taking the dot product of. In the second equation, the situation is different. Now we dot vectors from the same irrep, and so we are forced to point out that we cannot dot the same vector by itself and expect the result to be zero. Therefore, we have mn and m'n'. This equation is, of course, not applicable to one-dimensional representations. The third equation is when we dot the same vector by itself. Needless to say, we are in the same irrep. Here is the green vector dotted by itself, and we got 3, which is 6, the order of C3V group, divided by 2, which is the dimension of E irrep from which the green vector comes from. So it's time to combine these three equations into one. We can easily do this by using these delta functions. The full name for it is Kronecker delta. Kronecker delta is a function of two variables, usually just non-negative integers. The function is 1 if the variables are equal and 0 otherwise. It's convenient to start with delta ij. If I is not equal to j, then the vectors are from different irreps. The function becomes 0, right-hand side reduces to 0, and the vectors are orthogonal. If I equals j, then that means that we are in the same irrep. Now is the time for the other deltas. If m is not equal m prime and n is not equal n prime, then the two deltas take value 0, right-hand side reduces to 0, and the vectors are orthogonal. But if m equals to m prime and n equals to n prime, meaning that we are taking a dot product of the vector by itself, then the right-hand side reduces to h over li. Notice that we are under the same irreb now. Also, the dimension is always positive, so we can drop the absolute value sign. Also, mn refers to one irreb, so for instance, delta mm prime refers to columns of both vectors. Therefore, the two deltas, nn prime and mm prime, always return identical value. If one is 0, then the other is 0 as well. Sorry, I forgot to mention this star sign. It denotes complex conjugate of tau I r mn. For instance, in T group, imaginary numbers are involved, but we'll not be dealing with such groups, at least for now. The proof of the great orthogonality theorem is given in this book. You might need an assistance of someone who knows a bit more maths, not that your professor will demand that you know this proof, but in case you are curious, you will know where to find it. Now let's move on to the five rules, which are about irrebs and their characteristics. Rule number 1. The sum of squares of the dimension of the irreb of a group is equal to the order of the group. Please recall that the symbol of dimension is L. Cotton doesn't give the entire proof, but we can show that the sum of squares of dimensions is less or equal to h. First, let's notice that if a matrix is of order L, then there are L squared elements. So each irreb provides Li squared h-dimensional vectors. If, say, we deal with E irreb, it provides us with 4 vectors, and we've seen that. GOT requires these vectors to be orthogonal, and there cannot be more than h-orthogonal h-dimensional vectors, and that's it. I don't know how the full proof is done. Perhaps we would need to prove that these vectors span the entire RH. Anyway, let's apply this equation to C3V group. 1 plus 1 plus 4 gives 6, which is the order of C3V. There's an alternative way of writing the same equation. We can write it in this form because the characters of irrebs under E operation is equal to the dimension of irrebs. Rule number 2. The sum of squares of the characters in any irreb equals h. The basic idea is that it doesn't matter what we do first. Take a dot product of each vector on the diagonal with itself, and then sum up, and we already know that it will add up to h. Or, first take the sum of the diagonal terms in a matrix of an irreb, and dot this new vector with itself. To get from here to here, we just need to multiply out the numbers. So now we see that the black vector in the character table is orthogonal to all the other vectors in the table as well. Let's see how this equation is derived. As we already said, in the third equation of GOT, we are allowed to move in an entire matrix of an irreb, and that's why we have different symbols for rows and columns. Let's think what m and n really are. Let's say we want to construct an algorithm. Well, m and n are numbers from series of integers 1 to li. Here we have some example matrix of a three-dimensional representation, so the series will be 1, 2, 3. How we would modify the equation so that it only considers vectors on a diagonal? Well, we would use the same symbol to denote rows and columns, but notice one vector has mm and the other m'm'. That means that we can dot two different vectors that sit on the diagonal, but what happens if we do that? Well, we have delta mm', and in the case m is not equal m', it returns 0. So the next step is summing over m and m'. What does it mean? It means that we are summing the result of the equation of all combinations of m and m'. Again, both m and m' are integers from identical series of numbers, 1 to li, in our example li being 3. When m is 1 and m' is 1, the equation returns h over 3. We keep that in mind and move on. When m is 1 and m' is 2, we get 0. When m is 1 and m' is 3, we get 0 as well, and so on. And eventually we end up with 3h over 3, that is h. As we've seen on the previous slide, we can choose to do summation of terms on the diagonal first, and then sum over R. The sum of terms on the diagonal is just a character. So we have done with the left-hand side. The right-hand side is easy. We have seen that there will always be Li times when summing over M and M' returns H over Li. Rule number 3. The vectors whose components are the characters of the two different irrebs are orthogonal. That follows very straightforwardly from GOT. Taking a dot product of the two vectors from different irrebs gives 0. Just in this particular case, these vectors are on the diagonal of the two different irrebs. Now let's see how we would write it down. First, we would express the character as sum of diagonal terms. Notice that we are in different irrebs, so we don't need any m'. Then we swap the order of summation. That is, now we are taking a dot product of individual vectors, and then we sum over m. We know that this expression in brackets is 0, because it's just the first GOT equation where n is set to m. Now would be the time for the rule number 4, but in order to drive smoothly through the proof of the rule 4, I just want to make sure that we recall two properties of matrices. First, matrix multiplication is associative, so we can put brackets however we like and the result will be the same. The second thing that we need is that a character of AB equals character of BA. Just a side note, if you want to explore a little bit more on your own, you will find this property under trace of AB equals trace of BA, and I wrote a comment about the difference between trace and character under the video on E and T representations. The term character is good in the context of what we do, and that is what Davidson does as well, but there is a distinction. Basically, the sum of all the diagonal terms in any square matrix is called trace. The definition of character that I found is that in mathematics, more specifically in group theory, the character of a group representation is a function that associates to each group element the trace of the corresponding matrix. So sometimes when we talk about general properties of matrices, not only the matrices that constitute a representation, I will use the term trace instead of character. So let's return to our topic. Trace of AB equals trace of BA. To show you this property, I just took two 3x3 matrices and multiplied out the terms that make the trace. Basically, the trace in both cases are made of the same elements. This column is exactly this row. If you want to perform a formal proof, then take two matrices that can be multiplied from both sides and make the multiplication more generic by choosing letters as dimensions. So finally, rule number 4. In a given representation, reducible or irreducible, the characters of all matrices belonging to operations in the same class are identical. Since all elements in the same class are conjugate to one another, that is, they are related by similarity transformation, then all matrices corresponding to elements in the same class in any representation must be conjugate. Sorry for reading out, but it will be faster this way. So that is the condition of conjugation. If matrices B and P are conjugate, there exists a matrix A such that B equals AP A minus 1, and A minus 1 is of course the inverse matrix. The essence of this proof is to show that similar matrices have the same character. Let's call X equals AP and Y equals A minus 1. That gives us chi XY, and we know from previous slide that it is equal to chi YX. The last step is to take advantage of the fact that matrix multiplication is associative. Notice that in the brackets I said trace. As I said before, we call trace character because we are in the group theory. We are talking about representations and stuff, but in fact, any two similar matrices have the same traces. The proofs are identical. Also, the rule refers to irreducible and reducible representations. I am aware we haven't done reducible representations yet, so we can ignore it or come back here once we do them. Rule number 5, the last one. The number of irreps of a group is equal to the number of classes in the group. This is slightly similar to the first rule in that the full proof is not given, and we show the upper limit. There cannot be more irreps than classes. First, we combine the equation 2 and 3. Again, delta tells us that if we take a dot of two vectors that are made of characters of two different irreps, the result will be 0. Now let's introduce some symbols. Let k be the total number of classes in a group and gm the number of elements in the mth class. And we got this, where rp refers to any one of the operations in the pth class. We know that h-dimensional vectors are orthogonal. If we group elements into classes, the vectors become k-dimensional because we took k as the total number of classes in a group. What our formula is essentially doing is grouping elements of the h-dimensional vectors according to classes, and we showed with the rule 4 that the characters of all matrices belonging to operations in the same class are identical. Therefore, Cotton continues, the k-quantities chi l rp in each representation tau l behaves like the components of a k-dimensional vector. These vectors are mutually orthogonal, but please remember to take into account the number of elements in the class GP. The punchline is that we know that the k-dimensional vectors are orthogonal, therefore there cannot be more than k of them. Also, you might notice that we have chi L and tau L. Previously, L indicated dimensions, but I think what the author was trying to do is to use a letter that would embrace both I and J. He couldn't take K, so we have L. So, we are done. Now it would be good to do some examples, but I ran out of time, so we will do them in the next video. If you like, you can have a go at the questions now and check the answers in the next video. The task would be to construct the rest of the character table for these three groups, knowing only operations and the number of classes. So, see you in the next video.